Hello and welcome. In this segment, we will be covering file operations, file permissions, and file systems. There are three basic operations that we typically perform on our data: reading, writing, and executing. But the effect on our data depends on whether we are performing the operations on a file or a directory. Reading a file involves viewing its contents. Writing a file means creating or modifying it. And executing a file involves running a program or series of commands. With directories, reading involves listing its contents. Writing a directory occurs when its contents are changed. This can involve adding, deleting, or moving files or subdirectories. Executing a directory involves accessing its contents. This is different from reading or listing its contents. Suppose you have only execute permission on a directory, no read or write permissions. Also suppose that you knew that there was a file in that directory and you knew its name. You would be able to access that file, to read it or to copy it, but you would not be able to see what else is in that directory. Typically, every user of a computer system is given a user account. This allows the system to save personalized settings for that particular user. It becomes associated with that user's identity. Operating systems typically grant users permission to access files and directories based on their account. If a collection of users requires the same permissions, they can be combined into an entity called a group, and the permissions can be granted to the entire group. Each user can belong to many groups if necessary. Here, we have an example of setting file permissions in Windows. In the upper region, we see a list of users and groups. By selecting a user or group, one can specify the permissions that group or user has. That occurs in the lower region. In macOS, the process is similar, but there are some users and groups that are always listed. Every file or directory is created by a user who owns that file or directory. In this case, the owner is the user Stephen C. In macOS, every user is automatically assigned to a group, in this case, staff. The Everyone group represents any user who does not match any of the other users or belongs to any of the other groups listed. Beside the graphical representation, we see a textual summary in the terminal. This is similar for Linux. Again, note the textual summary in the terminal. R stands for read, W for write, and X for execute. Let's take a closer look at this. macOS and Linux summarize permissions using 10 characters. The first character is a dash if the permission is for a file. It is a D if it is for a directory. The next characters are divided into triplets. The first represents the permissions assigned to the user or owner of the file or directory. The second represents the permissions of the group. And the last represents the permissions of everyone else. So in this example, the file can be read, written, and executed by the user who owns it. It can be run and executed by the group and everyone else. The directory contents can be listed, changed, and accessed by the user, and can be read and accessed by the group. Everyone else can access the contents, but only if they know what they're looking for. Why would a directory grant access but not listing permissions? As an instructor, I might have a directory with instructions for an assignment and give that file name to my students. But because they can't access anything else in that directory, I could also put the assignment solution in the same directory and only give the students the file name after the assignment deadline. But specifying so many permissions for users, groups, and others can be cumbersome using 9 characters, so there is a short form method as well. By assigning numerical values to each type of permission, permissions can be set using 3 numbers instead. The number for each entity is the sum of the individual permissions. Let's put this to use. Here, we see the 1520 website on the EECS department server. This provides information about the course to those who have not yet enrolled and don't have access to Moodle. Depending on when you are viewing this video, the website might look different. In this window, I've logged into the Linux-based department server, and I'm in the directory with the 1520 webpage. Here, we see the files that are in the directory. The style.css file defines how the text and elements of the web page are styled. We can see that I, as the user, have read and write permissions on the file. My group faculty has read permissions on the file, but not write permissions and not execute. Others, everyone else, including everyone on the internet, has only read permissions on that file. Let's change that. I'm going to use the chmod command, that stands for change mode, to change the permissions on the file. On the other category, I'm going to remove the read permission. As we see here, the read permission has been removed from the other category. Let's refresh the browser and see what effect that has. The browser cannot read the styles.css file, so the appearance of the web page looks different. Let's go back and add the read permission again. Now, let's change the permissions on the index.html file. This is the file that represents the entire web page. It has the same permissions as the style.css file. This time, let's change the permissions using permission codes. We want to retain the read and write permissions for the user, me, so that's 4 plus 2, which is 6. We want to retain the read permissions for the group, so that's 4. And we don't want to have any permissions for the other category, so that's 0. And now, we refresh the browser and get... As an internet user, we are accessing the file as a user in the other category, and we don't have permission to access the file. So instead, we get a forbidden error. I don't want to leave the web page like this, so let's put the permissions back the way they were. And there it is, back to normal. We've mentioned file systems before, but what exactly are they, and are there different types? File systems control how data is stored and accessed on a storage medium, such as a hard drive, a memory card, or a USB flash drive. Storage must be formatted to a file system before it can be used to store data. File systems are not necessarily unique to an operating system. Most OSs support multiple file systems, but why not support all of them? All file systems are based on intellectual property and are patented. Companies who want to use a file system in their product, such as an operating system, a camera, or a tablet, must pay licensing fees to the company who owns that patent. And sometimes, that company can be a competitor. So what file systems are there? Let's take a look at some popular ones. Here we see the File Allocation Table, or FAT, file system. It was introduced in 1977. It's very simple, and there's no way to specify file permissions. In addition, no single file can be larger than 4 gigabytes. 4 gigabytes was unrealistic in 1977, but is quite commonplace today, especially with large images and video files. So why exactly is it still used today? Well, remember I mentioned that each time a company uses a file system in their product, they need to pay a licensing fee. One benefit of the FAT file system is its low-cost licensing. It's approximately 25 cents per device sold. So whenever you buy a device that uses the File Allocation Table file system, 25 cents of its manufacturing cost is related to licensing. The FAT file system is typically used in USB drives, memory cards, and consumer devices like cameras. There's a newer version of the FAT file system called XFAT, or Extended FAT. One benefit is the file size limit is much larger. Again, there is low-cost licensing involved, and it's typically used in USB drives and memory cards of 32 gigabytes or larger. The new technology file system, or NTFS, is typically used in Windows. The ability to specify file permissions and encrypt data is built in. In addition, it's more reliable than the FAT file system. The hierarchical file system, or HFS, is typically used in macOS. Like NTFS, there's built-in file permissions and encryption. In addition, it uses journaling to prevent data corruption. Journaling keeps information about a file being edited before it's saved. It's like a person keeping a diary or a log about their daily activities. If the computer system loses power, the journal information can be used to recover lost data and prevent corruption. The extended file system, or EXT, has various versions. It's typically used in the Linux operating system. Like the file systems for Windows and macOS, it has built-in file permissions. In addition, some versions use journaling to prevent data corruption. Here is a table summarizing which operating systems support which file types. Windows natively supports FAT, XFAT, and NTFS. This is understandable since Microsoft holds the patents to all three file systems. Support for HFS and EXT are available, but only by buying additional software from third-party companies. macOS does natively support HFS because Apple holds the patent. It also supports FAT and XFAT because those are commonly used in USB drives and memory cards. Newer versions of macOS also have read-only support for NTFS file systems. Full support for NTFS and EXT file systems is available via additional software. iOS only has full support for HFS file systems. This is mainly because it doesn't support external storage. Conversely, Android devices do typically support external storage and has support for more file systems. Linux has full support for EXT file systems and limited support for XFAT, NTFS, and HFS file systems. Again, support is available via additional software. In the next video, we'll talk about backing up your data. Thanks for watching.